Thank you very much, Dr. King. Well, thanks everyone for coming to our pain science lecture series. I'm Dr. Chen, or you can call me Q. I'm one of the pain management fellow at Stanford. And before I came to Stanford, I obtained my MD and PhD from Oregon with a study concentrations in neuroscience and pain circuit. So pain is occupied large part of my adult life. So today I want to talk to you about a subject that can be widely applied to almost all pain conditions, which is stress and pain. By the end of this talk, I want to help us to establish a knowledge framework between stress and pain and a strategy that we can use to modify the circuits and reduce stress. And the goal of stress reduction is to help us to improve the rehabilitation process and have a better functional outcome in the end, which is really the ultimate goal for pain management. So before I start, I want to give you an overview of the things that we'll go over in today's lecture. And it's really just four very key points. And the lecture, I will try to keep it brief to leave more room for questions and discussion in the end. But these four points, it's important to build up a framework that we need for a fruitful discussion. So first, we want to build a conceptual frame for our pain systems. And we'll use this framework to understand how stress can alter the pain system in both normal and the pathological states, so the disease state. After we define this relationship, we will then explore the interplay between stress and chronic pain. And finally, we're going to outline a couple stress coping strategies and how we can use these mechanisms to better our overall pain management and restore the function that is impacted by stress and chronic pain. And let's begin our journey by understanding how our understanding of the pain system has evolved over time. So pain is not anything new. The struggle with pain can be found throughout human history. In ancient Greece, Aristotle described pain as an evil spirit that enters through an injury. And because of the injury, the pain sensation was a punishment from the gods. But by the Renaissance, so over centuries, the philosopher René Descartes saw that pain as a disturbance within the body. And with a peripheral injury, the pain messages will pass through the nerve and reach the brain, and that's how we interpret pain. And of course, we now know that the pain experience is a lot more complicated than just a pain message passing through the nerve and reach the brain. And with the advancements in neuroscience over the last century, we now have a better understanding of how our brain interprets the pain. And I could go on for hours and hours to talk about the tiny nuance about nerve receptors, circuits, different brain regions on how each of them affect our pain experience. But we don't have time for that. And so I'm going to give you the most distilled form. So simple, in a simple concept, tissue injuries can lead to pain by having the nerves to carry the pain messages from the peripheral tissues to the brain, similar to what René Descartes was thinking. So these damages can be coming from arthritis, surgeries, nerve damage, or anything, any combinations of those, or any other stuff that you can think of. But the brain is much more than just a passive message receiver. It carefully controls how much pain signals it processes depending on the situations. And this pain-modulating functions allows you to run away from a threat by making your body less sensitive to pain or tells you to rest and take it easy while you are sick by making your body more sensitive to pain. So this system carefully regulates the pain so you can respond to the challenge in the physical and social world. And you can look at this simplified schematic on the right lower side, which is a balance of a pain meter. And it's a balance between the abilities to inhibit and facilitate pain. So let me give you an example of how this pain balance could work. So you can see from this picture that this gentleman has a lot of wound dressing wrapping around his arm and legs. And what if I tell you that these bandages are covering burn injuries that involve full thickness of his skin? And those are some serious injuries and they can be very painful. So knowing the extent of these injuries, this person should be in a lot of pain when the first burn happens. But what I didn't tell you was that this actually happens during the Montana Pine Creek fire in 2012. And actually I know this gentleman and he told me this, he did not feel the pain at all when he was burned. At the time, he was under extreme stress because of the fire, and the pain balance shifted to the pain inhibition side and allow him to save his properties and his life. And as he said on a later date, adrenaline is a wonderful and powerful analgesic. So you can see from the last example, not all stresses are bad. Our body maintains this ability to feel stress when we're in danger, when we are under threat, and we're under the situations that is beyond our ability to cope with the dangerous situations. And this can motivate and prepare our body to take actions and protect ourselves and get ourselves to safety. So it's in a very simplified term, it's a fight or flight response. In its essence, the stress engaged the organ system that will let us act quickly. So our heart rate will go up, our blood sugar will go up, our blood pressure will go up, we start to breathe pretty fast, our alertness will get dialed up to 10,000, and the muscle tensions will also occur. So if we need to run, we can just go. And it will also divert energy away from other what would be considered a non-essential functions, such as digestion, reproductions, or immunity, because at that time, we really don't need any of those. And in terms of your sensory experience, acute stress can make you forget about the pain by activating the intrinsic pain inhibiting pathways, and will also upregulate the endogenous pain inhibiting neurotransmitters, such as the endogenous opioid and endocannabinoids. So a lot of these pathways, like the amygdala, the hypothalamus, will be affected by the acute stress and start to act on the brainstem and promote pain inhibitions. And this way, it will give you the opportunity to get back to safety. And once you do, the pain system will reset and when the stress level decreases. So this is a wonderful system for us to get away from dangers and survive in many acute threats. But this system is also not perfect. As the stress becomes chronic, in some unfortunate individuals, their pain balance will shift to a less stable state. And you see that when the chronic stress occurs, it can facilitate pain. And it's done so by enhancing the pain facilitating signaling pathway. And our body becomes less sensitive to these endogenous pain-inhibiting neurotransmitters that we just mentioned a minute ago. So in this schematic that I pull from one of my publications, the pathway is essentially similar. It's still acting on the hypothalamus and the amygdala, and it still will act on the brainstem structure, the periaqueductal gray, the rostroventral medial medulla, but the balance have shift to pain facilitation. So as a result, the chronic stress can now amplify pain inputs. So at that point, even an innocuous stimulus, like a touch from a feather, like you see on this balance, can shift the pain balance towards the pain facilitation state and in turn cause chronic pain. But the cycle doesn't stop there. As we all know, chronic pain can also contribute to stress, anxiety, depression. So it's not hard to see how someone can be trapped in this vicious cycle that chronic stress and chronic pain just keep amplifying each other's negative effects, and then people will get trapped in the middle. So now at this point of the talk, we have built a concept of how stress and pain can affect each other. And we now have an understanding of how this complex reciprocal relationship between chronic stress and chronic pain can be developed over time. So let's talk about some strategies that we can use to help break this cycle. And it's gonna be a multi-angle approach. And I have to preface that there's no one magical bullet that can reverse the damage that is done by the chronic stress instantaneously. And we really can't expect an instantaneous fix, right? Because the stress-induced sensitized pain system did not develop overnight. So it's very hard to reverse that overnight. But fortunately, we can attack this problem from multiple different angles. So in the end, we can achieve an adequate level of pain management and functional restoration. So to simplify this, I try to break it down into three overlapping circles. That includes lifestyle modifications, and that include, again, if there's an injury, we'll allow the injury to heal. If there's an inflammation, we'll let it calm down. Exercise, nutrition supplement, and sleep. Psychological adaptations, modify our thoughts, mindfulness, coping, and social support, that we have things like having family and friends support, changing the environment, accept the culture, things like that. So there are significant overlap between these strategies, and we can use all of them all at once. So even though a lot of these may sound very obvious to most people, and it's important to understand why they're helpful. And this is what we're gonna spend our next 5 minutes to talk about. So let's talk about lifestyle modifications. And this may be no secret to a lot of people that physical activity, such as physical therapies, walking, swimming, jogging, yoga, bike riding can help strengthen our muscle and increase our energy levels, and which in the end will increase and improve our overall functions. And it's also important to realize that exercise also reduces psychological stress and also improve the overall well-being, which together can help manage chronic pain. Next, getting adequate amount of sleep is also important, because the lack of sleep will increase your stress hormone, things like cortisone that is can be amplified by stimulating the hypothalamus that I talked about previously. And by activating this stress hormone, it can further exacerbate the underlying pain sensitivity. And also eating a healthy and balanced diet is a very important aspect to maintain your overall health. If there's an injury, having a balance and having necessary macro and micronutrient can help your body heal more efficiently. And having all these nutrients will also support your body's function and keep and increase its longevity. And next, we're going to touch briefly about the psychological management. Because our pain psychology colleagues have a separate in-depth teaching on this strategy, so I will try to keep it brief. So I'm going to give you a bird's eye view of what we're trying to get to with the psychological modifications. It is important to emphasize that learning mindfulness and relaxation techniques such as meditations, deep breathing exercise, progressive muscle relaxation can help reset your mind in times of stress and improve pain management. So if you're in a very stressful situation, having these techniques can help pull your mind off that and in turn, you know, break that cycle from the very beginning. Another complementary strategy is called the cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT, which can help individuals to identify and change negative thoughts patterns related to pain and stress. And this strategy has been shown to help improve coping skill and promote relaxation. And together, they can help with stress reduction. Lastly, I want to draw you can also draw inspiration from your peers and your loved one too. And this includes your social circles, your family, your overall surrounding environments. These are some of the many different ways that can help cope with stress or even alleviate stress or prevent you to become stressful. We know from a lot of studies that having close personal relationships, patients with whom you can talk, with whom you can share your feeling with, can be extremely helpful. So spending time with your friends and family in order to maintain those relationships is perhaps one of the most crucial thing you can do as a stress reducer. So enjoy those times.